Car number five, who qualified seventh, made it up to sixth in the shootout and currently fifth now.
He was a little bit unhappy with his car in qualifying and said that it broke loose on him in the shootout in a couple of spots when he didn't want it to, but he thought it was a terrific race car and had very good consistency. And one of the things that Jason Bright is hopeful of is that hopefully now that these franchise agreements have been sorted out between the various key players, they're going to be able to get on with their testing program, which they've not been able to do during the year with the Team Brock cars.
So our PlayStation 2 race score shows you that from the word go, Mark Scaife took the jump on Marcus Ambrose, Ingle holding down third, Morris, Jason Bright, Todd Kelly through to sixth, Radisich in seventh, Lowndes in eighth, Murphy's in ninth, and John Bauer is in tenth position. Underway, flat out racing in the Big Pond 300. We'll take a break from Queensland Raceway and come back right after this on your home. We're back at the Big Pond 300 with Jason Bright under attack from car number two, Todd Kelly. Bright in fifth position. Kelly has moved up from his starting position, which was eighth, and is really starting to put a bit of pressure on the Team Brock Better Electrical VX in front of him. Remember that Todd Kelly this weekend is driving a brand new VY Commodore for HRT. Built from the ground up. Originally, they thought that Scaife was going to be driving it, but they've decided to let Todd Kelly break it in, if you like. And he is now edging ever so close up to turn four. There's hardly anything in this battle.
One of the real secrets to success at this racetrack is obviously crunching out a decent number for qualifying and shootout, Matthew, but it's very difficult sometimes to get the ideal race set up in order to maintain some pace and longevity in the car. And in search of that this weekend, Todd Kelly and Matthew Crawford, who engineers the car, have done a lot of work to try and look for the ideal performance out of the car, and they changed it quite heavily again prior to the shootout. They figured that the shootout was their last chance to make a reasonable assessment, see whether they could get a better race car, and Todd was reasonably confident that he had a car that was a pretty good jigger to be able to fight with through the race. Seaton's in.
Remember, the pit window opened on lap two, so Glenn Seaton decides to come in on lap 13. By the way, HRT expect to have their second new car, the sister car.
Glenn Seaton,
that's a big problem. He's gone straight in and parked it, and we understand that he slowed on the track. I think Greg Rust has gone straight down there to check it out. Hood's up for Cito as the FPR guys go to work. Rusty,
just trying to find out what's going on here, guys. The bonnet is up. Glenn's endeavouring to restart it. So we'll try and have a word of John Matthews down here, and we'll come back in a second.
Okay, mate, we'll check in with you ASAP. I was just going to mention that HRT car will be ready by Sandown, the other car, so they'll have two brand new spankers and the options they're considering.
This is the battle for 9th and 10th. John Bauer, if you recall, was all over the shop at the start there. I couldn't see exactly who was doing what to who, but he was out in the grass and he managed to climb back on, and he's progressing pretty reasonably at the moment. He's torturing the back of Greg. And their last laps were 12.6 and 12.7 respectively, but by comparison, Scaife and Ambrose 11.4 and 11.6. This is the problem all weekend for everybody other than really Marcus and Mark. They've had tremendous speed from themselves and their two cars, and everybody else has been scratching their head looking to try and close that deficit.
John Bauer's been top five here at Queensland twice, and Greg Murphy, who's now really under attack, has been on the podium here twice, third in 2000 and 2001. Remember last year, heartbreak when they ran out of fuel, that problem with the pickup, and that was the end of Greg Murphy's day. It was just one of those days for Murph and the Kmart Commodore team. Qualified seventh, Murph, and comes off the back of a fourth placing at Hidden Valley. He's fourth in the championship compared to John Bauer's 18th standing. We'll check out Paul Radisich and Craig Lowndes. Radisich is trying to tag onto the back of Todd Kelly for sixth place. So what you're looking at there is 7th and 8th.
Both those teams have had pretty successful tests in between Darwin and now. So both Radisich and Lowndes getting plenty of valuable mileage. Obviously Radisich being a Queensland-based team, as Richards now comes in, doing miles here at Queensland Raceway, which puts him in the box seat for this track, and Ford Performance Racing down at Phillip Island.
And the Castrol team tested this car.
Here, guys, have finished the rear wheels. Put the go-jacks on again. They're just waiting behind you.
2 weeks ago at Winton, 120 laps. Tyre change, Darrell Beattie.
Well, Stephen Richards, in tyre change, everything going as normal here. I watched the team before he came in. They were frankly talking about changing alternators and other things as well. So we'll wait and see what happens. Well,
they did make reference then. I heard them talk about the go-jacks. If you've got the go-jacks out in the middle of the race, you're about to swing the car into its bunker. So... and that's what they're doing. You can see just at the rear of the car there, they've got them positioned. They enable the crews to manoeuvre the car in its own length. And any time you wheel those out within a race, that means there's something fairly serious going on. And Richo's unbuckling.
Game over for Stephen Richards for the Big Pond 300, for now at least. This weekend just starts to slide further and further away for Castrol Perkins Racing.
Radio reference you just heard then, once it's actually into the pit lane bunker, as distinct from the working part of the lane where there's restriction on the number of people that can work on the car, you can throw any amount of people on it in there. So whatever their problem is, they can now dive in.
John Bower's finally got Greg Murphy. So Bower moves up to position 9 and Murph slots back to 10th. He worked on him and worked on him and worked on him, and he finally got him, probably at turn 3, I would say. Yes, it is. On the inside, a lock-up and a little bit of paint swapping, maybe. He did it the hard way, but he got there in the end.
Pretty good tight driving between both of them. John made the lunge. Greg recognised it, left a bit of space. Bowie had a little bit of dust going on the inside, and in the end, I don't think they actually did manage to touch, which was good hard motor racing between a couple of... blokes have done a lot of kilometres.
Haven't they? What? 166 championship starts for John Bower. 70 for Greg Murphy behind him. Your Shell Helix race update continues to have Mark Scaife out the front. You see there now that John Bower has taken over that spot from Greg Murphy. Tanner in 11th, Wills in 12th, down to 20th where Cameron McConville is. Let's check in on what happened with Glenn Seaton. More from Greg Rust.
Well, Matty, the go-jacks are out for that car and it is being wheeled behind pit lane here. What happened, Cito?
They just come out of turn 5 and then the engine just automatically just cut out, so it looks like it's done something electrical. I think it's the crank trigger on the front of the crank. It's actually knocked it off. And that's the end of our day.
That's heartbreak for you because it looked ominous here this weekend. FPR with their 3 brand new BAs. Things have been going reasonably well for you.
Yeah, pretty good. Off the start line, I had a really bad slipping clutch, so I had to cool it down for a couple of laps. But once that came good, the car was okay. It was circulating around. It's just a shame that these things happen, but they do happen. It's motor racing.
Hard luck, Glenn.
Glenn's sticking around in Queensland for the next few days. He's going to go for a blast. His dad is actually, Barry Seaton, has rebuilt an old Group C Ford Capri. Uh-huh. And he's going to hang around and have a blast in that. He said to me this afternoon that it'll be great, but I'll go for a slide. And I'm really looking forward to it. So that'll put a smile on his face and perhaps overcome the pain of this afternoon.
I reckon you're right. 15, car number 15 is in 14th place, and that is young Rick Kelly. And behind him is David Pinard, Seaton's teammate out of Ford Performance Racing. Rusty mentioned that they finally got all 3 BAs online at FPR, which we all know was only pieced together at the start of the season, and it hasn't gone Glenn Seaton's way today. It also hasn't gone well at Castrol Perkins Racing. Maybe Larry Perkins can explain it a bit more to Darrell.
Larry, this is not what you want to see. It's been a bad weekend so far. What's going on?
Yeah, it is a bad weekend. Well, the alternator stopped charging on the outlap, you know, from the start of the race before we even got to the grid, and we don't know why it stopped charging, but it did, and we were just about to press on and get the start done, and go to the battery volts. We no longer run the car, now we're changing the alternator.
Had an engine problem yesterday and another niggly thing carrying on now.
Yes, he started well back as the engine failed right at the qualifying lap, which didn't help, and so it hasn't been a good weekend.
Thanks, Larry.
Just to add some comment to that, as we watch this vigorous battle, what Larry's talking about. talking about there, without the alternator sending the required charge, it's just going to drain whatever power you've got left in the battery. So ultimately, they just sucked all the energy out of the battery, and that was what caused the stop in the end. Now they'll change that alternator.
Mark Scaife is the leader of the Big Pond 300. Marcus Ambrose still maintaining the rage, 0.8 seconds behind. On our screens, a good battle developing towards the rear of the grid, with Max Wilson deciding to start to take up the fight after starting this race from pit lane. Craig Baird's in there, Jason Richards is in there, so too is Bradley Jones and Jamie Wincup. Take a break.
You know, the most satisfying moment that we've had since VA Supercars have been around was, firstly, when you get to the point of winning races. Like, winning races is really, really something to experience.
Put your hands together, folks. Amazing victory. Paul Radisich and Junior Johnson are the winners of the Queensland 500.
The scene to forget about all the bad times and just only remember the good times. And going back a year or two, like, we had, you know, quite a few successes in the 1 year, which was extremely gratifying. So one would hope we've got a heap more to come, because I'm getting too old.
That was another Snickers satisfying moment.
And wouldn't Dick Johnson Racing like to turn back the clock a couple of years to 2001, when it seemed everything was going right for them? It's been a struggle for 2003, and also last year. Talk about going right. It's all looking pretty healthy for Mark Scaife.
It isn't. He's leading the race, and that part of the equation is good, but he's just lost a few metres in the last couple of laps to Marcus Ambrose. And the margin is now 1.2 seconds to this bloke, and they're both pacing very quickly. Scaife's last lap, he has responded a little just in this past lap. 12-1, 12-5 for Marcus. But it's been fascinating to watch, and Marcus has just edged back a little bit. And it's like it's been all weekend, Matthew, where we've joked between each other that it's a case of the first man to blink. You watch the two crews, you watch the two cars, you look at the two individuals driving these cars, and they are absolutely on it, pushing each other to the max. And they are now adjusting their cars, whether it's ride height, springs, shock absorbers, whatever it may be, in the most fractional increments. It's really quite extraordinary. Very, very good pressure motor racing for both outfits.
And that fight for pole position in the qualifying, to get to the top of the list in qualifying, sorry, not in the shootout, was kind of like a Mexican standoff between Ambrose and Scaife. They both posted some pretty good times, and they both just sat there waiting for the other to get out of the car. The good thing about this is that Stone Brothers Racing and HRT are side by side in pit lane, and they've been staring across the trolleys and everything else that's in there, and it's kind of like you say, the first man to blink loses.
1.39 seconds the margin, first to second now. And on the last lap, 12.3 for Mark and 12.4 for Marcus Gregg.
I'm down here with Kim Jones. Brad's car doesn't sound too good though, Kim. Can you tell us what's going wrong?
No, at Aussie Mail Racing, we're having sort of fickle day. JB's in ninth and Bradley's back at the back of the pack. On the warm-up lap, we cracked a header pipe, which is the exhaust pipe to take the hot exhaust gases out of the engine. And there's nothing you can do about it, providing that we don't set fire or anything. We'll just keep running around out there. He's actually just made up a place while we've been standing here talking. So it's not having a big overall effect on the car, but provide the gas doesn't get in and make him a little more sleepy, or it doesn't set anything on fire, we'll just keep cruising around.
Thanks, Kim.
No worries, thank you.
Brad's now moved up to 24th. Ford Racing have been conducting some very interesting analysis of the effects on drivers of driving a race car in this environment, as Stephen Richards is hopefully now ready to get back underway in what has been a pretty tough weekend for Castrol Racing, as Larry pointed out before. But some surprising and very interesting facts about core body temperature, the effects of some of the fumes, and many of the drivers and teams now have been aware of this for some time, and preparing their drivers and dealing with some of the effects of this in the best way that they can. And obviously, Matthew, with these endurance races where you're in the car for a long period of time, human performance, even though a few years ago people would laugh at you if you started to talk about bringing a chiro or physio to a race and managing your own physical output, is a very, very important part of the overall game. I mean, hundreds of thousands, millions of dollars are spent on the race cars, and now a lot of people are realising realising that some of the focus also needs to be obviously on the human performance. Smoke from BJ's car, so big smoke.
And, and that is going to probably be terminal in the end, because you heard Kim Jones telling Rusty, look at Jason Richards, he's dropping oil on the track. And leaving behind a trail of disaster for the guys behind him. All sorts of talk over the team radios. And they're trying to get Bradley to hit that switch to the top position.
They're blueing about some one of the switches in it somewhere. The diff pump switch. So they're trailing him to switch the diff pump on. And when it's heaving oil and it's got that sort of temperature like it has at the moment, then it's going to be a drama, and no amount of putting a switch on, I think, is going to rectify that. That's Kim on. It's Kim on the radio. That's Bradley calmly answering.
Well, they couldn't hear each other going down that back straight, down to turn three. And
it hasn't been a good weekend for Bradley. It's just the car has not responded. You can see the oil trail on the bumper.
So Brad Jones comes in now, and that smoke stopped pouring out for now. The Aussie Mail team calls him in.
Where it's been awkward for him this weekend is they don't get the same read out of this car that they do out of John's car, and it forces them to take a different approach to the setup on the vehicle. And they're just a little bit lost with it at the moment. Doesn't sound too healthy with a broken header. Sounds like an old Massey Ferguson tractor in the pit lane there at the moment. We have a bit of a look to see where the rear roll centre is on that thing. If we can stay out of there for long enough, we might be able to help him, give him some setup tips, you reckon, Matty?
Well, I know Rusty's standing by to possibly... Yeah, you're there. Have a chat to Bradley.
Well, sorry, I am, guys, just down here with Bradley. You're pretty dejected right now. Just describe what's happened here.
The exhaust broke at the start, and the fumes have burnt through an oil line. So, not a great weekend, Rusty.
You're rubbing your eyes. There's quite a noxious smell in the car. How hard is it from a driver's point of view when it's coming inside the cabin like that?
It's quite unbearable. To tell you the truth, it's terrible. So, as you can see, I'm all water, but it'll be okay.
He's away.
They're going to stick it in the garage, you can hear in the background. So you heard Kim on the radio earlier talking about the fact that they had the broken header, and then that means you can get concentrated exhaust gas in various areas depending on where it actually occurred in the header, and that can have a pretty ill effect on some of the other gear immediately around it. The temperatures in under bonnet are generally pretty astonishing anyway.
Check the state of play at the moment. You can see on your race score there as we go down to 15th. David Bernard, Stephen Johnson, Barguana. Back up the front, Mark Scaife and Marcus Ambrose. The gap is now 2.3 seconds between Scaife and Ambrose. So Scaife has just been putting down a few more impressive lap times than the man behind him. Russell Ingall is still in third, and Paul Morris in car 29 is in the hunt for first top five finish for the season. The best he's done so far in 2003, a 10th at Eastern Creek. We've got Glenn Seaton now in the commentary box with us. Have a chat to Cito. We understand what your problem was, Cito. I've heard you say it before. It's just the way of the world in this game, isn't it?
Yeah, thanks, Matty. It is that way. I actually haven't had a very good record. A bit like Cromwell. I haven't had much of a record here in Queensland. But, it's surprising, really. Like, off the start line, my clutch was slipping really bad, so I had to shut it down for a couple of laps to try and get the temperature out of it, and that's why we lost quite a lot of spots. But what's happened is coming out of just where Kando just came out now, turn five, it's just all of a sudden just shut down, and what's happened is somehow it's knocked the crank trigger off the front of the engine, which fires the sparks to make the engine go. So
it's not driver abuse, is it?
It's pretty hard. It's pretty hard to blame the driver for the crank trigger falling off. That's one safe thing. I can't say it's my fault this weekend.
You can say, hey, it wasn't my department.
Yeah.
The fatigue that we're talking about, we'll just take a look here at 66, which is Dean Canto in 13th position, and Rick Kelly is behind him in 14th. This fatigue that we've just been speaking about, especially when you've got a situation like Bradley where he's got fumes coming through the car, you didn't put down a whole stack of laps in that race, unfortunately. And, you know, you're quite red in the face. You look a little bit spent. 300k's a long way around here.
Matty, it's... Whoops, was something wrong with Bezzy's car? Or has he just gone late under brake? He's going again.
Yeah, he just got out in the marbles, I think, sir.
I think, Matty, it's probably my age at the end of the day. I'll probably show the heat a bit more. But, they're quite demanding cars to drive. And naturally, the fumes in the cars are probably the most difficult part to get used to. And Neil can really vouch for this. And probably, really, Bathurst is probably the worst place we go to for fumes. And you usually get out after the first stint and think, Jesus, I feel like I've done the 1,000 Ks already after one stint. So the fumes is the big critical factor in these cars. And most of us now use these filtering systems. But you still can't get over the top of that carbon monoxide poisoning, which really gets into your bloodstream from the petrol fumes.
The look of David Bernard's new car, he said to me at the start of the week, now I've got a BA, I've got no excuses. What's your take on the look of it, the feel?
I think they're great. Naturally, we've still got a way to go with our speed. Naturally, to have the three cars within a tenth of each other in qualifying is fantastic. But the cars just need that more edge in qualifying to get into the top 10 and probably more to the front. So it's going to take a bit more time. But at this stage, I'm reasonably happy with the way we're going. We've got some new stuff coming in the future, new engines from ProDrive and that. So I can see the light at the end of the tunnel.
And you guys were really... It was knife edge, wasn't it? You could have been in the top 10 had the ball bounced the other way, because we looked yesterday, one stage in qualifying, position 4 was on a 10-8, I think, and position 11 was on a 10-8 or a 10-9. So we're talking about slices in the realm of hundredths of seconds. So it's always difficult to explain to the audience just how close it is, Glenn.
It is exactly right, Neil. And, like, at the end of the day, you go around that track and you're on the edge everywhere you go in qualifying. You think to yourself when you come back to the pits, where the hell could I gain that extra tenth just to make the top 10? And like, you're on the edge in the braking areas, which you know, you've been there. And sometimes people, when you say, oh, we've qualified 12th, they think that you're not on the pace, but you're actually only 2 and 3 tenths off the pace.
We thank Glenn Seaton for coming up. Hope you enjoy a bit of fun while you stay up here in Queensland. Yeah, Conley's already given the game away that you're going to go banging around here. Nice piece of work for the next few days, but we'll...
Capri Works driver.
Yeah. Mark Scaife is the leader of the Big Pond 300, Bradley Jones. Well, it's not a good story for him. The helmet's off, he's out of the car. And at least now he can get some fresh air into the system. We'll take a break from Queensland Raceway. It's Scaife versus Ambrose at the top of the list. Back after this. Just over one-third of race distance now completed, and Paul Radisich is deciding to play Pied Piper when it comes to pit stops. He's the first man to go in and collect fuel. Thumbs up from the Briggs Motorsport team.
Pretty efficient stop too by the look of it, Matthew. Got the job done. The total time loss for a fuel stop here.
Oh, that's Dean Canto off of turn 3. 360, and David Bernard just misses out on a wing in the face.
You know how that happened? He picked the throttle up as the thing was rotating in an effort to try and catch it, and it almost ended in tears with him making contact with David. I was going to say, the danger at Queensland Raceway is that the total time loss from pit in, the fuel stop and pit out can be 55 to 60 seconds. And if you're more than 12 seconds behind the leader, you obviously go a lap down. So if you go a lap down, it can be bad news. Here's the replay. And he just gets out in the grey. Runs out of lock.
That was stage one of that, and that is stage two. Wow, that's close.
They have very little in the way of steering lock available.
He gets back on and thinks, how on earth did I get out of that? Back markers for Mark Scaife. That's Anthony Tratt. Now, Mark Scaife, by the way, is now clawing further and further ahead of Marcus Ambrose. Scaife, 3.3 seconds clear now of car number 4. You can see in between them is 2 other cars.
And just in the last couple of laps, Mark has made a little bit of a margin out of the traffic. And I've just seen a couple of shots of Marcus sliding around here and there. And so he's just slid the back of the car a little bit more on the exit of 3 and 6. There's the margin. Darryl, what can you add?
Yeah, Neil, HRT is starting to talk about a stop, and especially now Marcus starting to get into lap traffic. They feel that they don't want to lose time and let Marcus close that gap once they get into this traffic. Eventually, it's going to be ahead of him very shortly, so there could be a stop coming soon.
And DB, just as you were talking, the shot of Marcus going through one then was the car in a complete drift all the way through. So the rear tyres are just starting to get a little hot and sad. for the Pertec car, not overly affecting lap speed because both of them last time through 12.5, but certainly beginning to impact on the balance of the car. And a 12.5 incidentally plays sort of high 12s for everybody else. Morris Bright, Kelly Lowndes, Bow actually on the last lap of 12.3. So that's pretty handsome. Speaking of handsome,
this is what you're talking about, Neil, back to turn one. Look at that, sliding all the way over to the left-hand side of the circuit. And it was a repeat performance at turn two. When you said handsome, you're talking to me or Brad Jones?
I was about to say that replay saved me from what was the next obvious silly thing to say, which was welcome, Brad Jones.
Well, thanks, Bromley. It's fantastic to be here amongst two absolute professionals of the job.
I knew you'd be thrilled.
Brad, you've got the wrong room.
Yeah, sorry, I thought I was in with Barry doing circuit commentary.
Yeah, that was tough, wasn't it? I mean, we saw you when you were being interviewed by Rusty down there and the eyes were starting to water, and not only the frustration, but...
Oh, I thought you were going to cry on this.
I was crying. Oh. the exhaust was broken, so it's pretty gassy, and there's a bit of action.
Oh, Dumbrell versus Larkham. And Dumbrell comes off worse for wear, into the dirt, and now has to get it back onto the track, which he does so. And it was a case of take no prisoners there from Mark Larkham as he came through on the inside of turn five. That was battle for 19th and 18th position. Crunch, crunch, crunch. Get out of my way.
I think McConville's actually made a nice little gain out of that as well. So as Paul was out in the grass, he was able to make a couple of extra metres. Here's another view of it. Well, Larko was certainly well and truly up the side there. And two into one doesn't go. It doesn't take much to bump one of these things off the road. And Paul Dumbrell skates clear. He drops a couple of spots. It doesn't look like there's any sustained damage, which is good.
Cameron McConville's done the take on Mark Larkham there as well. So in between us seeing that live and then the replays, Cameron has slipped up on the in or out of Mark Larkham and taken that position off him.
19th and 20th, these guys. And all that little biff and barge session, that last lap of theirs was a 15.7.
Whoa, lock up for Cameron McConville at the same point where Larkham and Dumbrell went toe-to-toe.
They had some brake balance dramas with this thing yesterday that had Cameron off the road at one point. And it hasn't been a great weekend for them. They had a really good test at Eastern Creek last week. And this is the frustration of V8 Supercar Racing as Larkham now peels off for his CPS. And they thought that they had a better handle on the car in preparation for this event, but it hasn't really translated. So, Queensland Raceway, as Bradley will fully attest, is a very strange place. It looks very simple on paper, six corners, but it's a nightmare, isn't it, BJ?
Absolute nightmare, because what happens is your car will get a little bit tarly through one and two, and then we'll push understeer all through the middle section. So then you trim your car up and you make it with a little tiny bit understeer through one and two, but it's undrivable through the middle section.
It's so like you can fix either half, but fixing the whole circuit is a real nightmare.
Exactly, and the point we're at to in the race now is everyone's tyres are getting a little bit worn, they're all trying to drive straight, but what's really happening here is everyone's playing let's wait and see what the leaders do, because it's such a short circuit, you're not wanting to go a lap down. There's Stevie Richards climbing out of his car.
He had two bites at the cherry, Stephen Richards, and I'd say now that is game, set and match for Richo on lap 40 of 96. Cameron McConville in 1999 had his first ever podium finish here in the Queensland 500. He's been suffering the flu for the last week or so, and he joins a long list in the driver department for that kind of activity. Paul Morris has been pretty crook as well. Stephen Richards has jumped back in. He refuses to lay down, and now they're pushing the Castrol car number 11 back out for another crack. That's it. I'm sick of writing him off.
Yep.
Because once he was out the second time, I thought that was it.
I was sort of hoping he'd stay, because if you finish in the top 30, you get your appearance money. If you're outside the top 30, you don't. He's just knocked me off on 31st, so I get nothing. That's the story of my life, really.
The bumps on this circuit, Bradley, there's quite a few of them, and the general consensus is they're getting worse.
Oh, they're definitely getting worse. Into one, and three, they're quite bad. There's quite a significant dip on the way down into three, and you've almost got to ease off your brake a little bit and then get back on it to get the car to pull up there, and you're doing, you know, 250 k's. You look at them bounce over those bumps there, trying to get the right amount of rebound in the car so it rides those bumps nicely and doesn't skip across the top. It's half the trick to going fast around here.
And BJ, when you're on the approach to one, I know last year it would almost bounce your feet out of the pedal box. Is it like that this year when you go for the brake pedal?
Absolutely. It's here we go. We've got Kelly in here. What's he going to go for? Fuel. Which is really interesting because I would have sworn most of them would go for their tyres first, but a lot of them are tending to top the things up with fuel, which is a longer stop. Personally, I would have waited and gone for the fuel in case there was a safety car later on the race.
As Todd Kelly comes in, that battle between Craig Lowndes
and
John Bow is a battle between two very good movers. Here's Cameron McConville also getting juice on board. John Bow started in ninth. He's moved up to sixth. And Lowndes started in 11th. He's moved up to seventh.
Ingles in.
Russell comes in for Stone Brothers in front of Cameron McConville, who is now exiting pit lane.
Now is a dangerous time of the race because those people that have actually come in, most of them have gone a lap down. They're on good tyres or they've got a tank full of juice. It's a danger period for those people because anybody can slip off the road, get a pace car, boom, you're a lap down, and you'll stay that way for the majority of the race. So it's a really tricky time, this part of the race. Never comfortable if you're one of the first ones to pit.
And you also get a mishmash of performance between different vehicles. Suddenly a car that earlier in the race had a certain level of performance gets a new set of boots on while you've got an old set, and you've got different guys at different speed levels, which is why it often ends up in a brawl at this stage of the race. And as Bradley said, you get the cars off the road in a pace car.
And you heard Campbell Little there from Stone Brothers Racing just letting the enforcer know that he had a clear track exit so he could come barreling out and rejoin at turn one. Round 11 at Silverstone, the British Grand Prix. Formula One is tonight after the movie. Probably joins Billy Woods to bring you up to speed on what's happening there. Rubens Barrichello has pole position and Mark Webber in 11th. We understand that Mark Scape is getting the call to come in. Paul Morris has already got his. And they're having a look under there while they just do a fuel stop at the rear. You can see head down, nozzles in.
Once these leaders have come in, you'll find them drop like nine pins. They'll all start to come in.
And you will see in pit lane as one of the Valvoline cars comes in as well. Scaife is about to come in as well. We understand for fuel, Marcus Ambrose is going to come in for tyres. Anthony Tratt needs to get himself onto
yes.
the right.
You can't spend too long in that working lane because, or that manoeuvring lane, or that you'll cop a drive-through penalty very quickly. You must yield now to the driver in the fast lane. His Scaife, we understand he's coming in.
Yep. Now this is the guy that literally has been...
Too much throttle, Mark. Do you not want to do the roll centre, or do you reckon wing's better?
Should hear the answer, or maybe they're going to keep that quiet.
Robbie, when you go back out like now, it'll use too much travel up. When the tyres are pressure, it'll be too understeering probably. So, sort of caught in the middle there. I reckon just come out on the rear pressure frag.
So he's suggesting he just drops the rear tyre pressure down.
You'll get a guide when they come off, so let's just make a sense of the decision.
Now this is the way it's been all weekend. Scaife versus Ambrose.
And the interesting thing is here, one's going for tyres, one's going for fuel. So Ambrose will be the fastest car when they get back on the track. Scaife will be holding, hoping he can hold him up, because when he gets his tyres on later in the race, he'll be off.
And right now, Marcus Stop. Ambrose gets out ahead. Of course, he only did tyres. Remember that Scaife is still taking fuel on board. It's always going to be a longer stop.
Go,
he's clear to go.
And what he was talking about before was just repressuring the next set of tyres that have come on the car and just taking a whisker out of the rears.
And the thing is, to change the roll centre or the rear wing, when you put the fuel in it, you've got 30 seconds. It's plenty of time to do it. When you just do the tyres, you've got 6 or 7 seconds. It needs to be a fast change, and so you don't have a lot of time to react.
Now's the time to take a look at the times of Marcus Ambrose now that he's got fresh rubber on. So Lowndes has completed his pit stop as well. So too is Greg Murphy and also Jason Barguana. We understand that there's more dramas for car number 11. Stephen Richards has received a black flag for pit lane speed. When things go against you, they come down in buckets in this sport. Mark Noski coming flying down the main straight Greg Murphy gets back out and rejoins the race, and here comes Bradley's teammate, Johnny Bowe.
Well, I was hoping he'd come in because he's racing with Lowndes. Lowndes stopped the lap earlier. He needs to get in, get his tyres on if that's what he's going to do, and get out in front of him while Lowndes is getting a bit of heat in his tyres. Try and hold him up so then he can make the pass because they were close.
Pretty good run so far from JB Bradley's. You probably didn't see it, or you may have spotted it, but he was in the grass on the way down to turn one at the start of the race, and he was out in the weeds all crossed up like a sprint car. But he got back on, and he's actually been pretty effective throughout so far.
He's done a great job this weekend. Last year here, he was very fast. We were a bit unfortunate not to end up on the podium, and likes his place, done a lot of laps around here, and certainly knows how to get the most out of the car.
Well, Stephen Richards has found his worst round to drop.
He definitely has done that, hasn't he?
Yeah, right. When you get out, you're going to get your head down as hard as you can again.
Remember, the fuel flow rate for refueling is about 4 litres per second, and 44 laps down out of a 96-lap race, so you can work backwards from the amount of fuel that's going in.
And as you know, on these 300k races, you're only allowed to refuel once, which I find a quite a bizarre rule.
Ooh,
because JB, not cold tyres, but heavy in the back. He probably hasn't screwed enough brake onto the rear of the car yet to get the most out of it. But they've got to make sure they get more than enough fuel in it. As we saw, when a few of them running out of fuel, you're not allowed to top up. And if you get a DNF, you're at the back of the field. So you've got to make sure you get enough fuel in there.
And the fuel burn here is about 2 litres a lap. I mean, it depends on who you talk to team, and the way their engine's configured and what sort of grunt they make, but that's a basic average.
Not surprisingly, Marcus Ambrose has just posted the fastest lap time of the race, a 1:11.068. Let's check in with Daryl Beattie. Daryl?
Well, obviously it's working for him, Matty. I just spoke to Ross Stone. Ross said we're originally going to stick with that plan. The main reason is that they can make an adjustment to the car and really see what advantage they were going to get out of it, so they can make some time back on Mark's gate before they go for the fuel.
And if you'd asked me, they've done the right thing. I would have gone for the tyres every time. That would have been my choice.
We didn't actually ask you,
but I told you anyway.
It's always welcome. Don't worry about it, Bradley. We might take a break. Remove Crompton, keep Jones in. Simon Wills is race leader on the road, but he's yet to pit. You can see the blue boxes. One pit stop for Marcus Ambrose, one for Scaife and one for Ingle. It's a double pit stop kind of day. The Big Pond 300 is developing into a game of mental warfare. We'll come back on your home of motorsport right after this. Could be crunch time now. Mark Scaife comes in to change tyres. So he will have done his second compulsory pit stop. He came in on lap 43 for fuel. Now lap 47 for tyres. Remember, all this time, Marcus Ambrose is out there putting down fast laps. On fresh rubber, and so close between the Team Brock car and Paul Wheel.
And they have to circumnavigate that witch's hat in the middle of the road there, because they're not allowed to exit in the slow lane. They must exit in the fast lane, given that they're at the very end of pit lane. And it's an added complication for HRT down there.
So now we know this. Both Scaife and Ambrose have fresh rubber on board. Scaife has already got his fuel, so he's topped up. Ambrose hasn't.
Really tough decision for HRT there. Ambrose has gone out. He's got the fresh tyres on load, fuel load, and he can go really hard. Mark is a bit wounded. He's got a full tank of juice, so he had to go for the tyres to try and keep a decent pace up. But I think you'll find the fallout will be when they finish doing their circle of stops. So Ambrose is yet to stop. He will still be in front of Mark Scaife. So that's going to be a hard job for Mark to overcome.
Just a bit of time comparison as Russell Ingle now comes back in once more to do his second stop. He did fuel on 42, so tyres on 48. Marcus went out and did an 11.06 when he changed tyres, as you mentioned, Bradley, on a lighter fuel load. We kept our eye on Mark Scaife this morning in the warm-up with a fresh set of tyres.
Russell, you're going to have to feed into the new cars here.
And a full tank of fuel, he did an 11.26.
I thought the HRT tyre stop looked a little bit slow, if anything, certainly relative to Russell's stop there, for example. They were a little bit slow on the front left for some reason.
Well, by memory, it was an 11.1 second stop, which is...
just didn't look quite as smooth as I've seen some of them. Yeah. And that's very easy to do, mind you. Really difficult to emphasise just how difficult it is to handle the rattle guns, deal with that hot working area and slide what is a heavy wheel and tyre apparatus on and off the car quickly. They're not easy to handle and get back on the pegs.
It's great to see David Thexton still out there finding his feet.
Look at this.
In the world of V8 supercars. And here's a battle between Jason Barguana and Greg Murphy. Side by side, Simon Wills is there in car 44. He's already had arguments. You can see the result on his driver's side door. The big dent on the inside. Down to turn six. Inches, centimetres, not enough. Wills, contact with Murphy. Nobody harmed in the incident. They all maintain their positions and get a level head for the main straight. Greg Rust.
Matthew, just to update you on the Simon Wills situation, he pitted a lap ago, and while they were doing the pit stop, the compulsory fuel stop, they took both front wheels off, made a couple of adjustments, a couple of clicks on the front shocks. Simon mentioned to me this morning that he was worried about the way the team dynamic car would be during the race. Very happy with its speed in the shootout and qualifying, but he just worried about the way it would look after its tyres during the race. That has obviously become an issue.
And in his qualifying lap yesterday and in the shootout, the car certainly looked very nervous in the rear end. It was pointy. And that was one of the reasons why they managed to squeak it into the qualifying in the shootout. His time right at the end there was a fantastic time. One of the art forms here, Bradley, as you know, is to not only have a car that qualifies well, but one that you can calm down sufficiently so that it races comfortably and looks after its tyres over the duration.
Well, and what you're saying is 100% correct. I followed Simon around for a couple of laps in the warm-up this morning, and his car does point very well over at turn four. He doesn't use all the road. There's some bumps on the outside there, and he turns in from the inside of that, and a car with a lot of point is what's needed to do that. So then you have to tame it. You have to make it so it's really comfortable to race. Not many people except for Oscar would pull some front wheels off and adjust the shocks during a race, but that's the sort of edge you need to stay competitive in the class at the moment.
Stephen Ellery put fuel in there. He's another who's been bedridden with the flu throughout the week. They did a test and also tested his endurance partner for 2003, Luke Yulden. Here comes Ambrose coming flying down the main straight.
That was Murphy in the background there too, Matthew, so he's come in and taken service.
So both pit stop boxes ticked for Russell Ingall and Mark Scaife.
Tyres for Murphy.
Pulling out on average 1 second to lap, Marcus, so keep working hard, mate, because once we get that fuel in the car, it's not going to be so good. We're going to make it up now.
And that's the bottom line, isn't
100%
it?
Correct. They need to make hay while the sun's shining, and if he can put a lap on, Scaife can continue to do that every lap. With that, one thing we don't know, is he putting the time on Dumbrell, Morris, or is he putting the time on Scaife? I'd suggest it's Scaife, because that's anyone they've got to worry about at the moment.
What they're trying
and
to do
is going to be in traffic.
As you pointed out before, Bradley, their trick at the moment is they're trying to make as many gains as they can with a good tyre on a light fuel load. So yep, there's probably going to be some, well, not probably, there is going to be some speed in that.
And the downside of that, of course, is when he gets the fuel in it, he's not going to be able to run quite as fast as Mark Scaife, certainly for a little while. And so then the job is for Mark to try and find his way around him, which is always the most difficult thing to do.
And sometimes the tyres don't like that. Darrell?
Neil, I spoke to Jeff Gretsch just now on the pit wall, and I said to him, why did you guys come in back-to-back and whack the tyres on now? He said, we had no choice of the way Ambrose went, so maybe you can read into that a little more.
I think that says it all, really, doesn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, I think it does. I was just sitting there pondering the answer, but
there's no post. Well, that's exactly the way we picked it. That Marcus has got a strong pace going out there at the moment. He is still in the 11th, the only bloke on the circuit capable of doing that at the moment. And if he keeps this up, I think Mark would be lucky to even catch him, let alone try and get by him.
Well, everything's looking pretty handy for Stone Brothers Racing, with Ingall and Scaife both completing their pit stops around about the same time. So they've both got fresh rubber and a full tank of juice. And currently Russell Ingall is in front of Mark Scaife as Paul Dumbrell now comes in for his first stop of the day. On lap 52, the V8 Superstars at the Logan Entertainment Centre. Tomorrow night, and tickets are still available. Please phone that number on your screen, 07-55-37-6376. Tickets still available. Give them a call in the morning especially.
Come and see me. Well, I'll be fresh, you can be sure about that.
It's all about me, isn't it?
Me, yeah, that's exactly right.
It's the makeup that's a worry. Now, Ford Performance Racing's David Bernard is in. Did his fuel on 46. So seven laps later, comes in and gets a fresh set of rubber. Anthony Tratt and David Thexton make their way out. Greg Rust has got more from pit lane.
Well, Matty, I have to say both of them were a little on the untidy side. David Bernard's left rear took much longer than it should have to get on. And Anthony Trapp, they actually dropped that Toll Ipec car off the jacks with the rear right not quite on. It could almost pop out off the car. They had to put it back up on the jacks and refasten it. And having said that, now car two in pit lane, Todd Kelly.
And Tundler will be collecting tyres. That'll complete the duties compulsory-wise for the Holden Racing Team. At the moment, the PlayStation 2 race score will show you that Marcus Ambrose has the race lead with one pit stop still yet to go. Same story for Paul Morris and Jason Bright. Mark Scaife and Russell Ingall down there. 9th and 8th. And Paul Wheel holding down a top 10 position at the moment. New rubber for Todd Kelly. We'll take a break at the Big Pond 300. Now, thanks to Bradley Jones. Come back and join us after this.
It's also falling over on the exit.
We are listening to Marcus Ambrose as he comes in talking to the Stone Brothers Racing Team.
In the fuel reset and the brake bias, would you stop with here, please?
A crucial stop. Lap 55, Marcus Ambrose gets fuel on board and Darrell Beattie is there. Darrell?
Everything going to plan at the moment. One guy down on the left-hand rear tyre, checking pressures, Matty, but everything going to plan. Nice stop, as you know, fuel takes a while.
Doesn't it? This will shake it all down. And it's just he stalled in pit lane. And almost contact. Yes, contact in pit lane between Ambrose and Ellery.
Are you all clear to exit, Marcus?
That's disaster. A stall, a split second stall, and Marcus Ambrose puts.
Got it. Well ahead of Scaife. Russell and then Scaife.
Puts his race on the line, and here's the man who's waiting to pounce. Along with Russell Ingall, Mark Scaife is out there. He was caught in some traffic, we understand, while Marcus was doing that stop. But in terms of what's going on in that car, couldn't have happened any better for him. What happened to Marcus Ambrose? Out in front of him is Russell Ingall. Let's see what's happening. And we understand that because of this, in pit lane, Marcus Ambrose will get a drive-through penalty.
Yeah, Bradley and I were just talking about it then, and Brad picked it 100% right. You can't do that. You can't just run into somebody in the lane, so he's now going to cop a penalty.
Shake of the head from Marcus Ambrose, who was so close.
Sorry about that, Paul.
Yeah, absolutely.
Sorry, Marcus.
Here's Jason Bright comes in. Everything was going to plan for Stone Brothers and Marcus Ambrose. It was picture perfect up until that point. Jimmy Stone grabs the bottom lip, thinks things are starting to go wrong at the very wrong time. There's Campbell Little.
Well, there was just a sequence of things there. There was the stall, which then puts the driver under pressure, and the rearward vision is bad enough. And he's gone out and...
And there you go, that would have been the net result. They're saying it would have been a 10-second lead.
This is all good news for Russell Ingall.
Absolutely.
So the battle will focus down to Ingall and Scaife.
Well. First to blink. And that's what's happened. The tiniest of mistakes. We talk about it on the track being hundreds and thousands of seconds. Most minute details in this sport derail an entire afternoon, an entire weekend. Weeks of testing, hours and hours of hard work from all crews, engineers, drivers. And it comes down to this. Marcus Ambrose, in the box seat to make it 5 straight championship victories, now finds himself in the slowest seat out there. 40 kilometres an hour pit lane. Drive-through penalty. Just a
clear entry.
Look of despair from the 26-year-old.
I'd have to say that he handled it pretty well.
Marcus, the next car ahead of you, I think, is Scaife. And he's just about to go into turn 3.
You know, he asked for confirmation of it, they confirmed it, and he's just gone about doing the job, which is what he's got to do. There was no carry-on on the radio, and his heart rate stayed under control, so he's just got a job to do now.
And that's been the impressive thing about Marcus Ambrose, keeping that heart rate, well, where it needs to be. Now let's take a look at what all this means in terms of your race score. You can see now that Russell Ingall has the race lead, 2.07 seconds ahead of Mark Scaife. Take Marcus Ambrose out of that picture for the moment. Then you've got Jason Bright, Todd Kelly, Paul Morris, Dumbrell, who's yet to do both stops. Radisic there in eighth. John Bauer still inside the top 10. So a bittersweet moment for Stone Brothers Racing, as the favourite at that moment, Marcus Ambrose, trips across the line in pit lane. His teammate Russell Ingall fires away.
40 laps to go and you're plus 2 seconds.
2.1 seconds, in fact, over Scaife. The Enforcer versus the five-time series champion.
This will be a good battle. Russell's got some traffic to deal with here. Every tenth counts. Last time through, it was 12.2 seconds. 112.2 for both Ingall and for Scaife. It's pretty handsome speed.
And Ingall goes through on David Thexton to turn five. Car 99 gets wide and leaves car 9 alone. Russell Ingall won it back here in 1999 when he partnered Larry Perkins in the Queensland 500.
Scaife got a better run on Thexton there, so Russell was the net loser in that traffic manoeuvre.
A year later, Mark Scaife won it in 2000 when he partnered Craig Lowndes.
Made 7 tenths on him.
So 1.38 is the difference now. A 112.89 for Russell Ingall that last lap, a 112.16 for Scaife. And here's Jamie Wincup in car 33, who's down in 22nd position. The hard charger out of our last round at Hidden Valley. Youngster qualified 29th, moved up to finish overall 20th, but he finished 11th in the third race. And wouldn't this be a moment for Russell Ingall? Remember, he has won a race in the BA Falcon, but not in terms of the championship. You have to go all the way back to the Melbourne Grand Prix.
Interesting that the last lap through for Ambrose, 11.5. He's comprehensively the fastest man on the racetrack at the moment. And Lowndes is pretty quick as well, down in ninth place at 11.9. But he's still third, Ambrose, and that's very, very good car speed.
Things just change in an instant, don't they? So Ingall first as he comes across to complete another lap. Scaife second. Ambrose is there in third. So as Ingall and Scaife attack turn one for another lap, Ambrose comes around on turn six. Still in third position, as Neil mentioned. Jason Bright's behind him. Saturday games in the afternoon, Melbourne versus Essendon, of course, round 18, and then a couple of games in the evening depending on which market you're in. Check it out, AFL on 10 every Saturday afternoon and night. And don't forget comprehensive wraps in sports tonight right across the weekend and throughout the week as well. Team Better Electrical moves along, and Team Noski, with Mark Noski missing the rear assembly of this car, which was taken off earlier on in the race, now gets Juice on board. So car 23, tick both the tick pit lane compulsory stop boxes. There is Dean Canto, who had a wild spin early on in the race. Now he's got it all back together. What an eventful afternoon. Russell Ingall, Mark Scaife, Marcus Ambrose are your top three. Greg Murphy is still in the top 10. This is the Big Pond 300 at Queensland Raceway, the seventh round of the Supercar Championship. Back after this. There is our race leader of the Big Pond 300, Russell Ingall, who is 2.2 seconds ahead of Mark Scaife. And Marcus Ambrose is consistently putting down 111s and has now reduced the deficit to be 12.5 seconds behind. He's effectively picking up around about half a second per lap on the guys in front of him. While we're in that break, I was watching the timing monitor, and Marcus was consistently doing 111.6s or 111.5s. And Russell Ingall and Scape are both doing low 112s. But on the road, when you see it in terms of meterage, boy, that's a long way. Rusty in pit lane can update us. He's got Simon Wills, Greg.
Yes, Matthew, down here at the moment, it's disappointment for Simon Wills. I guess our viewers watching live through TV1 in New Zealand will be wondering what happened. It was a good qualifying run for you.
Yeah, we had a good weekend up until the race. Unfortunately, everything went wrong in the race. Started off, I ended up getting hit by Murph. I got a big ding in my door, and then my steering went left-hand down. My cool suit failed, so started getting hot. And then right at the end, the distributor sounds like it's gone, so that's the end of the race for me.
Good luck.
Yeah, well, thanks.
Darryl.
Thanks, Rusty. Well, it seems down here with that incident with Ambrose earlier on, definitely the blame has gone to the car controller, that's for sure. But as far as Russell goes and Marcus goes, Stone Brothers keeping it close on that gap between Scaife and Russell as well. But Marcus, the man hitting the hot laps at this stage.
Yeah, he certainly is, Darryl. As we take a look at Stephen Ellery, who is on the road in front of Russell Ingall, but not line-up. Super Chief Auto's car.
He's down in 19th at the moment. The race leader just coming up behind him with the headlights on. Ingall to Scaife, 2.3 seconds. Then it's 12 seconds further back to Ambrose. Todd Kelly, Paul Morris still having a good run in that new car. Jason Bright, series leader, still well positioned to grab another big bundle of points. Paul Radisich, another great performance from him. John Bow, Bradley's teammate there in 8th. Here's Marcus in 3rd.
There's another 111.9 from Marcus. Those last two laps for Scaife and Ingall were into the 112. So you can see on the top of your screen there the Ambrose versus Scaife time battle over the last 5 laps. Each one of them belongs to Ambrose. The difference now is 11.5 seconds all up. And after that disaster, it was much, much more than that. So it's a case of head down and keep the times coming as Russell Ingall gets through the back marker and Stephen Ellery, who, by the way, is coming off a top 10 finish at Hidden Valley when he finished in 8th position. This is his 80th career start for Stephen Ellery, but
Russell just acknowledging the courtesy then from Ellery, who made some space for him going into 4. Now, we tried to get rid of him, sent him down to his wife, Mel, and she threw him back up at us. So we unfortunately got Bradley back here again, everybody.
Terrific. Great news, Neil. Well done. Congratulations. What we all want to hear.
Tell me about the BA Falcon. The Stone Brothers have got their two cars working very well, but you've had a lot of difficulty in particular with your car, and it doesn't seem that it's clear-cut. A wonderful thing to have necessarily. You've got some views on that.
Well, the BA is a very, very different car to the AU. It's the first time that we've tried with any real parity aero testing, you know, make the things as similar as you can. And I'm to tell you the truth, my AU is nicer to drive at the moment than my BA. And
why do you think that is?
I think that the BA, certainly at where I am, has a tendency when you try and get onto the throttle and you're trying to come off the corner, the back steps out. So it's very hard to find a nice balance in it, and it's very pitch sensitive. If you look at some of these cars going around here, you'll have a look at, even in the same team, Marcus Ambrose has probably got the best setup at the moment to Russell Ingall. You look at the back of the cars, they're different height. Each individual is trying to get something. The car is so sensitive, you've got to tailor it to your needs, and it's not easy to find the sweet spot.
And they've certainly done a great job with their car, and in particular with Marcus's car, haven't they? But they had great speed with their AUs as well. But you finished the season at the end of last year, and you had your AU firing very, very well. I'm a bit curious as to why the cars have been fiddly in different hands. Some people are having great success with them, and others are not.
Well,
looks like a pad change going on with
unusual.
Jason Richards. Neil, that's spot on. I actually can't believe what's going on here, and I don't think Jason can either. He's sort of shaking his head. There has been some deliberation about this problem down here at Team Dynamic for a few laps now. They were sort of
arguing whether, I guess, to bring him in. There's the disc looks incredibly scored as well on the front right here, but they are changing the pads on car 45. I've also just ducked next door to the Sierra May Wines team. Paul Morris banking some good times in that brand new VY Commodore at the moment. And both Nigel Barclay and race engineer Paul Seprinich gave me the thumbs up. They said the car is good, but I guess I'm wondering why he's maybe not a little further up the order. The answer to that may be in his slow pit stop for tyres. They had dramas with the front left. It took much longer to get the wheel nut off the front left on Morris's car. Perhaps he could be higher than where he currently is.
They're squeezing caliper pliers there, which suggests they're going to do a pad change. And if it's got scores on the rotor, Bradley, it suggests that it might have run out of pad material.
Quite possibly. They must have a terrible wedging problem or something, because you just don't do enough laps around here in 300 k's to wear out a set of pads.
And it's not noted as being particularly hard on pads.
We are taking a look at 34 and 15, which is Garth Tander, who's in position number 11. And Rick Kelly is coming up as position number 12. So that battle's been going on for quite a while. In front of Garth is Rick's teammate, Greg Murphy. Check out your website, v8supercar.com.au, especially in the lead-up to the Enduros at Sandown and Bathurst. That's where you'll find all your driver pairings. And here's Paul Morris that Rusty was talking about. He's in fifth position at the moment. He was a beneficiary of a little bit of bump and grind between Todd Kelly and Jason Bright that effectively put Todd Kelly in fourth position and Bright back to sixth. And in the movement that happened, Paul Morris snuck in and claimed fifth as well.
Not a lot of difference in pace between these two. This is Morris has had some good showing so far this year. They've certainly turned that team around from where they were last year. They've made a lot of personnel changes, and even though this is their test track, at a few of the other events he's showing that he's got a fair bit of car speed going this year.
Well,
so
he hasn't been out of the top 10 all weekend at various practice sessions, qualifying and so on. So he's had a good strong run this weekend.
Here's Dean Canto.
Good job. You've still got 1.2 seconds to Radicic.
Jason Bright with the PlayStation 2 race score has the honours at the moment by 2.19 seconds to Russell Ingall over Scape. So it's still Ford versus Holden at the front. Marcus Ambrose continues to chip away at the times. He's now 9 seconds behind. We'll take a break from Queensland Raceway. This is your home of motorsport network. A man on a mission, and he is fighting the clock at the moment. Marcus Ambrose in third position. He's pretty much out there all alone. He doesn't have too much traffic around him, and what he's doing is hunting down seconds, microseconds. Ambrose versus Scape is third versus second, and look at that, the last five laps, 76 down to 72 inclusive, have all gone Marcus's way. In fact, lap 76 was 0.8 seconds better.
This is better pace in this stint of the race than Marcus showed in the first stint. And Bradley, I suspect that they made an adjustment to that car in the last stop.
Well, he's moved.
See.
Yeah, I'd say they did a roll centre adjustment. They just certainly didn't have time to do anything to the shocks when they had the wheels off the car. That was a fast stop, and they didn't do it again when they did the fuel. So I'd say they've done a roll centre adjustment, and the car has liked it. He's certainly got a fair bit of pace. He's driving calmly. He's not angry. So he's done a fantastic job. That car looks very fast.
He's driving the wheels off the thing as well at the moment, just sliding it here and there, but not lurid slides. You can see the car's being pressed.
He's got
not
missile lock.
Out of shape.
Yeah, he's got missile lock on that thing, Escapes. You can see in his eyes. You know, they're continually telling him the gap, it's coming down. That gives you confidence. He's squeezing on the throttle. He's not overreacting. He's doing a very good job, and it's very purposeful. Look at the way he's holding himself in the car. He's very focused on what he's doing, paying attention to the things around him.
Making a lot of bar adjustments on that car, and I sort of suspect if you watched him on board for a whole lap, you'd see bar adjustments in various spots around the track. Lowndes used to do that around here as well.
Absolutely. When your car is close to being right, you're trying to get the most out of it. What he'll do is he'll pull the rear bar up for one and two, I'd say. Pull it back down so it's not so taily. Then pull it up so it turns better in the second and third gear corners in the midsection of the circuit.
Speaking of Lowndes, the siege continues between the Cat Ford and the Aussie Male Ford. And the battle there is for ninth and eighth position. Greg Rust in pit lane.
Well, Matty, I'm with Craig's former engineer, Oscar Fiorinotto. Can you tell us what happened to those brake pads? They were absolutely eaten out on Jason Richards' car. Why would that be?
Well, Rusty, what happened? The
Jason had a bit of an altercation early on with one of the cars. Unfortunately, it's damaged some of the ducting, which has caused the brake to overheat, and hence the excessive brake pad wear.
Hard luck. Thanks, Oscar.
Thanks.
Back to the race between Lowndes and Bowell. And that's Radisic for a position just in front of them, so they'll all be going pretty hard here. Seventh, eighth, and ninth. There's Radisic in seventh, Bow in eighth, Lowndes in ninth. The times comparative are leading the way, lending a helping hand to Craig Lowndes. Four out of the last five, the one that he missed. Here's a move. He's not going to get him there. At turn three, will he get him on the inside?
You won't get around him there, let me tell you.
John Bow drifts wide, now up to turn five. Side by side. This will be turn four, in fact. It's got the left-hander.
Aggravation potential, hasn't it?
Hasn't it? What?
Disaster written all over it.
Lowndes has a look on the inside. Now turn five. Shoots down to six. This has been a great battle between the 1995 series champion, John Bow, and, of course, three-time series champion, Craig Lowndes.
And Radisic would be enjoying this. He'd be looking in the mirror going, oh, thank God those two are going at it because they're not getting close enough to attack me. And JB would be trying to block Lowndes out but not knock too much pace off, because if he can get into a battle with Radisic, it's going to make it even tougher for Craig. So they're all, of course, being a bit careful because there's only 16 laps to go, but you always want to get that extra position.
Incidentally, on the back of that little train is Dean Canto. We saw he had a loop early on in the race, but he was stranded with a jammed gear lever. And he's lost a bunch of laps in what was otherwise a pretty strong showing. He qualified very well this weekend, very close to that of his teammate, further restoring his confidence after he was put on notice at Darwin.
Yeah, which certainly doesn't, from a race car driver's point of view, does not help you at all. And you know, it's nice to know that you're going to get to the end of the season in the job that you got. I think he drives very well. What people don't realise is to get into this class, the competition ramps up immensely from the Konica series. You look at all the ex-Konica guys that are in here, and it's just taking them a while to find their feet. And that's because it's a tough, tough business. So I'm glad that John Briggs has decided to give him an opportunity to run to the end of the year, because he's a good little steer.
Dino made his V8 Supercar debut here in 1999 at the Queensland Raceway. And as Bradley mentioned, in the Konica series, he took out that series, the inaugural Konica series in 2000. Back to business for Marcus Ambrose. Makes a quick adjustment in the cockpit down the back straight.
You can see he's taking a little bit of rear brake off the car. So he's just squirting a little bit of front brake on it. He's probably chewed through, 20 litres of juice or something. Every 15 to 20 litres, probably someone will come on the radio or he'll know. Just pull a little bit of rear brake off the car so it's get a bit more on the front. Getting a bit lighter at the back, you want more braking power at the front. Keep your car balanced.
And if you don't do that... the cars can be prone to locking the rear brakes, then you skid into the corner and you make yourself prone to a spin.
Exactly. So you run as much rear brake as you can get away with in these cars, and then you just sort of go, OK, it's locked, let's just go half a turn forward from there.
Stone Brothers Racing talking to Marcus. They've got a list, a lineup for him to tick off as he goes around the closing stages of this Big Pond 300 and tries to reel back the disaster that happened in pit lane, effectively put him in this position. Next on the list is Anthony Tratt, the back marker. There he comes now at 75, a little bit loose. And that is Marcus's target for now. But the real target is Mark Skate. And those last five laps Ambrose, continue mate. To be green for Ambrose.
It's got nail-biter potential. We're 81 laps in, 96-lap race. He continues to churn out 11s. I don't think I've seen him, other than maybe some spot traffic here or there. He's constantly been in the 11s. Even the last lap was an 11.9.
And here's John Bow putting the move on Paul Radisic down at turn three on the inside. JB gets him.
Look at that. That's
Craig Lowndes too. Will Lowndes hold that position? Yes, he does as well. So Bow gets seventh, Lowndes gets eighth, and Radisic goes back to ninth.
Look, I can be JB's Arthur Daly and up his fee by another 10% now, if you like.
Yeah, listen, I'm having trouble feeding the family as it is. What's interesting about this dice itself, well, the dice was, oh, JB down the inside of Lowndes. Must have had a bad run out of that hairpin. And he's going to have Lowndes all over him, whether he likes it or not, till the end of this.
Craig was really comfortable when I saw him just before the start of the race about the way his car was behaving as a race car. He felt like it was going to be a good settled car and he'd get plenty out of it during the afternoon, and it's proving to be the case.
Listening to what he's saying is...
14 laps to go, Marcus. 14 to go. Keep it clean, pass train. Keep it clean.
Hopefully hopefully Anthony Trad will let Marcus by here. Yep, early break there. Marcus is down the inside. Now, what's interesting just in front of this piece of action is Mark Scaife hasn't been able to get past Stephen Elry, which suggests that the pace just isn't quite there. You see them in front of him. Elry has maintained that gap to Scaife, so there's no doubt that Marcus will be hunting him down. Now, what could be going on here is the air pressure adjustment that they've made with Mark's car hasn't had the reaction to the car tires. that they were looking for. Yeah, it's all fun and games at the moment, and it's all playing into the hands of Russell Engel. As Mark Scaife continues to try and get in front of Stephen Ellery, Marcus Ambrose is joining the freight train. But the times are getting further ahead for Engel. It's a 3.6 second difference now between first and second, and Ambrose is ready to pounce back after this. An extraordinary driving performance from Marcus Ambrose, and he's now zeroing in on target number one, which is Mark Scaife. You can see the difference. Don't worry about the clock anymore. He's right behind him, down the main straight. 85 laps done. They begin lap 86 of 96. And Marcus Ambrose is now right at the tail of Mark Scaife for position number two on the track. In front of them, 3.7 seconds clear of Scaife now is Russell Engel. Stone Brothers have had their disasters and they've bounced back as Ambrose puts...
You've got plenty of time, mate. Keep it clean.
Two over the edge on the exit of turn two.
Someone further up the road had a big lock up into three then.
And I think that was actually Russell or someone around him having a bit of a moment. Because he'll know what's going on. He'll have been told on the radio, or he'll see in the mirror that these two are together now, and he'll be wanting to get out of there quick.
What a stellar performance, and what a way to bounce back from the disappointment that was thrown at him in pit lane. He's done everything that he was meant to do. Quite clearly, he's got pace to match it. It's just a matter of, can Mark Scaife hold him out? Can Marcus Ambrose get in there and get past him and put Stone Brothers 1-2 on the track? So much intense focus in the lead up to this race between these two men. Remember that Ambrose is going for five straight championship victories. Scaife did that last season. Only Jim Richards and Alan Moffat have done five or more in the touring car history. So there's been a lot to play for here. Everybody's going Burko down the fence. Yeah, it's been like that for quite a few laps. What's really interesting about this dice, when we look at these two cars, Marcus can drive almost anywhere on the track, which is usually what HRT can do. He can roll over a curb, as we see him clip one there, but on the inside, and he can turn in from three quarters of the way out on the circuit. Where you watch Mark in front of him is using all the circuit. He's coming over to the apex. He's using all the circuit coming out. You watch that car a little bit oversteer on the way out. Marcus is certainly got a better tool at the moment, and he's driving the car really well and incredibly hard. And Mark Scaife is doing an incredibly hard job there too, holding him out now.
But you know, catching Mark Scaife and getting by him are two different things, and he's used to pressure, and he'll be in no rush to let Marcus go by.
He predicted to me before this race that it was just going to be one of those good solid races. It'd be good fun, he said. I don't know if it's fun at the moment, but it's great for us to watch.
The other thing through these two corners, the closer Marcus gets to Mark, as you can see, he's getting away a little bit there. That's because he's losing the air on the front splitter. He's losing some of his aero, so the car is starting to push off the corner. You saw him with the dust up on the outside, so he's got to get close enough that he can have a run at him. But the closer he gets, the more air he loses off the front of the car.
Oh, that's as close as you can get, Brad. Let's check in with Darrell Beattie.
Ross, after what happened earlier, you wouldn't believe that Marcus could have catched Mark Scaife again.
Yeah, when he wanted a good call on timing, I thought that was a bit optimistic, but he got his head down. I think he's been pretty hard on his tyres, so whether he can do anything about getting past Scaife or not now, I don't know.
Unbelievable car speed, Ross.
Yeah, it is. I'm not sure whether Scaife's car is as good as what it was at the start of the race. I don't know, so time will tell.
Thanks, Ross.
Okay.
Right in the cockpit there as we thank Ross Stone and rejoin this battle around turn six. Sets up an intriguing battle at Orange Park the next round in a few weeks' time. You'll see it on 10, 2:30. Sunday the 17th of August.
12.5 on the last lap for Ambrose, 12.6 apiece for both Ingle and Scaife.
There's no doubt that Ambrose is being held up.
The interesting thing when you watch a replay here of Lowndes getting up the inside of your teammate at turn six.
And claiming position number seven off him. So they've swapped it.
And JB leaves tons of space, and that's a very intense battle. Whoa. Speaking of intense battles, it's interesting to look at the speed that Marcus can carry into the corner, Bradley. Yeah. You know, he's really got some great speed on the way.
Oh, nudge. Has he got him? Has he got him up to turn four? He's got him. Marcus Ambrose claims the position off Mark Scaife.
Something wrong. That's
And a big blow. Again. Two years in a row, engine troubles for Mark Scaife here at the Queensland Raceway.
Keep working at it.
And Ross Stone said something telling before. He wondered whether these guys had lost some pace relative to earlier in the race.
Oh, listen to that. Mark Scaife has put down all sorts of fights and held off all sorts of challenges. And in the end, you've got to listen to this car as it trundles into pit lane. A repeat performance of 2002. Jimmy Richards and Mark Scaife launched an engine at the Queensland 500, and now it appears as though it's happened again.
Pretty cruel thing on the 89 laps into a 96 lap race to work that hard with no yield.
Yeah.
I think though, can you believe this year? Mark Scaife's words.
And it's Mark Scaife.
I don't think this has affected his earlier pace, though.
Frontals in, and it looks as though it's all over there. Take a break. Do a sweep of pit lane, find out exactly what's happening. And, oh, what's happening to Mark Larkham? He's gone deep, really deep, and he's just going to dig himself even deeper.
Is that a safety car issue, I wonder?
I should think so.
He's off at turn two. He's just gone straight ahead between one and two, and... he's a long, long way from anywhere where I've seen people before, so it may not produce the safety car. There he is.
He's in a long way, that's for sure.
Well, with only five laps to go...
he nearly got it to the grass, you know.
Oh, dear, there's the end of Mark Scaife. That is the end of Mark Scaife's day. Can you believe this year? That's what he said. Stone Brothers can believe it, because at the moment Russell Ingle and Marcus Ambrose now look as though they're going to go 1-2 in the Big Pond 300. We need to take a break. We need to take a breather. Come back. We'll be right back after this. The closing stages of this race. Back shortly on your home of motorsport. It's an ever-changing script here at Willowbank. Heartbreak for Mark Scaife. His race is over. After dueling with Marcus Ambrose and holding on to second position, it all came a cropper at about this point on the circuit. And we thought that Ambrose had him on speed and position alone, but it was much, much more to that. And now it comes down to this. Ingle versus Ambrose. Can Russell Ingle hold on for his first championship win in a Ford Falcon? Has Marcus Ambrose got enough time left to get past his teammate and make it five straight championship victories? Whatever, they both hold on to the end.
Oh, there you go, Marcus. You've got a big gap behind you. Let's just stay cool. Make sure you bring it home. We don't want any incidents there.
It's literally win-win for Stone Brothers Racing and Ford once again.
And this is a little bit of sugar for Russell Ingle, who got off to a great start at the Australian Grand Prix meeting in Melbourne at the beginning of the year, and then at different stages during the year, luck has deserted him. There's been some strange failures and weird things. The problem off the start line at Darwin, the straight-ahead shunt, the end of the start-finish straight at Wanneroo. But now a big bag full of points and potentially a juicy win for him.
The sun smashes through the right-hand side. The enforcer's car number nine, he does. He also looks very trim, very fit, very focused. He's really put the hard work in this year. And we know for a fact from Ross Stone, who's been speaking to our guys down there in pit lane, there'll be no team orders here. If you're wondering, are there any subplots at play?
With only three laps to go and 4 seconds between them, I don't think it's ever going to be an issue.
There's Campbell Middle, Jimmy Stone. And remember, they came here last year, Stone Brothers Racing,
And three to go, Marcus, three to go.
They broke the duck for Ford when David Bernard and Simon Wills crossed the line. It wasn't a good day for Marcus Ambrose in 2002. They ended up finishing fifth with Paul Wheel, but they're going to go back-to-back. Quite extraordinary, isn't it? This man has had everything thrown at him today, not to mention the overbearing pressure of that PR machine that's been on his back. Can you do five straight? It's the question everybody's been asking him. His answer is, I need to get out there and just race, do what I do and keep the focus on that. 96 laps is what I'm focused on. Here's Todd Kelly.
Flying the Holden flag in third position from Paul Morris, Jason Bright. So a little bunch of Holdens there, third, fourth and fifth. And Lowndes, Bauer, Radisich, Murphy, Rick Kelly, Paul Wheel, David Bernard, Stephen Johnson, Paul Dumbrell, Stephen Ellery, Cam McConville, Jamie Wincup, Barguana, Baird and Tratt. That's the top 20. Great performance here from Morrison, a season best fourth.
Actually, that's probably the best result he's got since he won at Caudle a couple of years ago. They've done a very good job with that car this weekend. It's been quick right from the get-go.
Paul was very impressed with the torque and engine performance from the new engine, the Holden Motorsport engine. This is Jason Bright in fifth, still taking away another big bundle of points.
And he looked to be, he's driving very smart. He looked to be struggling there for a little while, especially when Kelly and Morris were on him, and even though there was a bit of elbowing go on, he let them go and he's just kept his head down and he consistently keeps on grabbing the points, which makes him a definite outright contender.
Someone's got a bit of your disease out there. It sounded like a broken header on one of those cars. Very noisy, something that went past us there in the last few seconds.
You mentioned Jason Bright. He'll walk away with 168 more points. JB, by the way, has had that left indicator on for around about 95 laps now, and we understand, we'll update you at the end of this, but we understand that Marcus Ambrose will move up to second in the championship and start getting closer to Jason Bright. The difference will be about 30-odd points. Paul Radisich looks as though he's got a problem. Car 65 in eighth position. Well, Greg Murphy's gone around him like he's standing still.
One of the Valvoline cars was limping, and we know that Tander's out, so it must have been a Wincup.
And Radisich has dropped a second a lap, so he is in trouble at the moment.
Oh, there goes David Thexton. Thexton in a puff of smoke. Goes round after being helped along the way by Greg Murphy. Remember, Thexton down in 23rd position. And Murphy goes shooting on past. So he's got past Paul Radisich up to eighth. The gap between Russell Ingall and Marcus Ambrose as the Ford flags begin to fly proudly is 3.4 seconds on your final lap.
Terrific performance.
And Russell Ingall comes around turn three. Marcus Ambrose follows him. What an extraordinary day's racing. The last time that Russell Ingall stood on top of the podium was Winton 2001 in his days as a Holden driver. Remember, he did win at the Melbourne Grand Prix, a non-championship round. He was pumped for that one. But I guarantee you that this will be the sweetest victory of all for Russell Ingall. His first in a BA Ford Falcon. And he will lead an extraordinary sweep for Stone Brothers Racing. The Enforcer returns to the top of the podium. A 1-2 for Stone Brothers Racing. Marcus Ambrose second. Todd Kelly third. I bet you there is emotion like never before inside that cockpit, because Russell Ingall so dearly wanted this win, and Stone Brothers go side by side for a victory parade lap.
Hey mate, obviously you know you're going to come down here to pit lane and line up under the tower.
That's Campbell Little talking to Russell Ingall. That's a very, very popular victory for the Enforcer, who's switched camps for 2003. He's worn it on the chin, and it's thumbs up from a fellow Ford mate in Stephen Johnson. What a day. The Big Pond 300 has been nothing but ecstatic for Stone Brothers Racing. Once again, one of those days
full of heartbreak and bad luck for Mark Scaife and Holden Racing Team, although Todd Kelly manages to get on the podium in car number two. A wonderful performance and result for Paul Morris. Jason Bright continues to bank up the points. Craig Lowndes finishes in sixth. John Bow in seventh. Greg Murphy in eighth. Rick Kelly there in ninth. And Paul Wheel rounds out our top 10 performers. David Bernard in his new BA Falcon finishes 11th. Then it's Johnson, Dumbrell, Ellery, McConville, Wincup. We go all the way through the field for you. Barguana Baird, Anthony Tratt in 19th. Jason Richards, didn't Team Dynamic have their troubles? So too did Mark Noski. Canto, Thexton, Max Wilson. Quite a few laps behind, but the story of the day, Russell Inge. Certainly one time when Russell Ingall and Marcus Ambrose would not mind being called pineapple heads after taking out the Big Pond 300. Ingall and Ambrose make it an SBR 1-2. Of course, they drink milk at the famous Indy 500 here in Queensland. They suck on a bit of pineapple juice when they claim the victory. Let's take a look at how they finished for top 10 points for the championship from today. And Russell Ingall gets 192. Ambrose puts 186 in the bank. And Todd Kelly gets 180 points. Another top 10 finish for Paul Wheel out of Team Brock. As far as the championship picture goes now, at the halfway mark of 2003 championship, Jason Bright continues to lead, but Marcus Ambrose is moving ever so close. Ingall moves up to fourth, but look at Mark Scaife, stuck down there in seventh position. As we mentioned, Todd Kelly was flying the HRT flag. He finished third. He's with Greg Rust.
Well, Todd Kelly, that was a remarkable race and a great debut for the team with the first ground-up built VY. How was it?
Yeah, the car's a little bit hard to drive still, but as far as what the guys have done with it, build it, and this weekend, it's been a fantastic effort. We've come a long way with it from when we first got here and till the end of the race, so the guys have done well.
We've just come off the back of two rounds where we've had three 100k races back to the 300 format. How do you feel?
I actually don't mind it. You know, it's probably an advantage for us younger, fitter-type blokes. I don't know how Russell got through, though.
Cheers, Todd. Well done.
Thanks.
Well, Marcus, you wouldn't have thought after that pit lane incident today that you would have come through that strong.
Yeah, really disappointing. You know, we had a really good car. We made some adjustments during the pit stop and it was all under control. And, you know, I started at the refueling, you know, kicking myself and then pulled out in front of Steve Ellery. So I hope Steve finished the race all right. You know, it's just one of those things when you're under pressure, you make mistakes and it's just unfortunate. But if I could get beaten by anyone, it better be Russell. So great effort by the team.
The performance of the car, and not just the car, but you, unbelievable today.
Yeah, man, I was really angry, and I just pressed on. I didn't say anything to the boys, just tell me the gap, and that's all I want to know. And, you know, I really pressed on and really drove the wheels off, and just so proud that I can do it in the car because, you know, we put so much work into it, and it's the effort of 2-3 years of really hard work. So, you know, it's a fantastic day, really, all around.
Marcus, congratulations, and thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
Well, in front of a record crowd here at Queensland Raceway, 53,000 fans for the weekend. How does that feel?
Mate, I think I've been inducted into the Queenslander. I'm a Queenslander now, apparently, so it's all right. Look, it's really good. It's been a while coming. Look, we knew it was always there, but we've had a torrid run, and, mate, the guys have worked hard for this one, you know. It's been a couple of horrid meetings, and to get up the pointy end and get a win, yeah, she's a bonus.
Talk us through the race for you, because the focus seemed to be on the intense battle between Marcus and Mark, but you were there. Everything was going so right for you today.
Yeah, I mean, Mark Scaife was very quick on the first stint, and I was a bit worried because I thought once we come out and got all the stops out of the way, I thought he might be able to peg me back, but the car was better in the last part of the race, you know, the middle to last, and when I started gapping him, I thought, yeah, this is all right.
How does it feel for Russell Ingall? It's been a long time coming. You started the year with a bang. How satisfying is this?
Oh, mate, it's been a while between drinks. I can't remember the last win. Forget the Grand Prix, like, last championship round win was a while back, and
if it
was
2001.
2001, dead set. Jesus, I didn't think it was that far back. In that case, it feels bloody good, I can tell you.
But, well done, Russell.
Let's hope there's a few more.
Plenty more to come. Well done.
Thanks, guys.
Even the enforcer was surprised to know that it was back at Winton in 2001 was the scene of his last victory. But I tell you what, the champagne is tasting pretty good today. Not only because Russell Ingall gets his first championship victory for Ford, but also, as I mentioned, at 1-2 for Stone Brothers Racing. Quite a historic day for the Falcon boys, and they're deciding to hoop it up on the podium there. But we all know that this game is a game of pleasure and pain, and on that side was Mark Scaife. He's with Neil Compton.
Driving down the pit lane, he said to his crew, "I can't believe this here." And Mark Scaife, I mean, how tough a break is that one to go through, what, 7/8 of that motor race? Any early clues as to what the problem was?
Honestly, you don't know, Crompo. I mean, it's a cruel game, isn't it? You know how tough it is. And the car was just fantastic in the first part of the race today, and it lost a fair bit of speed in the second part for whatever reason. It felt like it had really bad, like, rear grip. It was very oversteering. I wasn't as competitive in the second stint, but I was still going to be there. I mean, I was still going to finish on the podium.
Yeah, any indication as to why that might be? We heard you talking on the radio about the possibility of repressuring the second set of tyres. Did you change the tyre pressures, and do you think that might have had an effect?
Yeah, look, it took half a pound out of the back, which I know, you know, sounds weird to the people at home. You know, you take half a pound of pressure out of the back, and I thought that would have been a gain. And in the end, it finished. We've done the tyre pressures on the car as it come in, and it finished a pound and a half up on the first set. So clearly it's got more slide. When you get more slide, you generate more heat and more pressure.
And some engine-related drama, no early indication as to what it may have been?
I saw Marcus coming, and I certainly was going to make it a very wide Holden Commodore for the last five laps. And when I turned it in the middle of the corner, I sort of had it right. It was okay. I put my foot on the throttle on the seven cylinders, so really don't know.
And we were kind of discussing about the possibility of whether or not you were going to make it a wide Commodore, or in fact we're going to sort of aim for points given the way this point structure was. So you're quite happy to fight for it?
Oh, absolutely. I think it's a sort of place, mate. You know, if you make good exits, especially out of turn two and out of the two slow ones, it was going to be pretty hard for him. I mean, I know that he had car speed on us for sure. I mean, there was definitely a real speed gain that he had, but you know, we're certainly going to be a battle.
You've always been extremely strong at Oran Park. Can you serve it back to these blokes in a few weeks?
I'd like to think so. I mean, it'll be on for young and old there. It's a great place. It's a great racetrack. You know how good it is, and our cars have always gone well, so I'm looking forward to it.
Look forward to seeing you in Sydney. Sorry about today, mate.
Thanks, mate.
Mark Scaife now has to regroup for our next round, but this Super Sunday of motorsport is not finished with yet on Network 10. Tonight, the Formula One Grand Prix from Silverstone, Rubens Barrichello with pole position. Jarno Trulli will start on the front row of the grid, and Mark Webber will start from 11th. Join Billy and Neil after the movie tonight. Don't forget V8 Superstars at the Logan Entertainment Centre. That's the number on your screen if you'd like to get some tickets. Give them a call first thing tomorrow morning, and the next time you'll see the V8 Supercars will be at Oran Park in Sydney, another 300-kilometre race from 2:30 to 5, Sunday the 17th of August. You'll see it on Network 10. Well, that's it for now. We hope you enjoyed the coverage of the Big Pond 300. Quite an extraordinary day's racing. I'm Matthew White. On behalf of the entire Network 10 commentary and production team, it's goodbye from Willowbank.
Well, OK, the spin probably never learned to anything else. So.
In his eyes, yeah.
Go, 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 go